those tough times that you did endure, those tough times that you did overcome, sometimes you might forget that if you're too humble. You got to understand that you've been through a lot and you've conquered a lot. So you have to be aware of that. But being balanced with the savage aspect to where it's like, man, I'm a dog. I can get this done.
Certified. Right.
I'm going to do it.
What makes the journey worth it? The pain, the adversity, the opposition, the challenges, the uncertainty. Why do I have to go through this? What's the lesson in this? I got a paralyzed right arm and hand. The million-dollar question I get every single day is, you wouldn't change what happened to you, why? Serendipity, join us for insightful dialogues about not just successes, but about failures, opposition, adversities that shape and mold the individuals to who they are today. I'm Inky Johnson. This is Serendipity. Hey, what's going on, guys? Welcome to Serendipity with Inky Johnson. Today's guest, man, is a friend, like a brother, Eric Berry, you know, NFL player's son, just a great all-around guy. He's a warrior. And so we're going to get right into it. EB, how you doing, man?
I'm good, man. How you doing?
I'm all good, man. First and foremost, I just want to say thanks for your time, man. I know you're out ripping and running, making it happen, so I greatly appreciate it.
Yeah, you know it, no doubt, man. I'm glad to be here with you, man.
No doubt. So, E, the reason I started like this platform was basically because I feel as if in life, like as people, a lot of times we waste experiences, right? When they don't show up in the form of which we expected, or when we go through things and they don't turn out the way we want them to, whether that be something great, whether that be adversity and opposition. And so serendipity, the whole basis of it is when we go through something and in the moment we're like, man, why I got to go through this, or why I'm experiencing this? And then you look up a month later, a year later, you know, a week later, and you're thankful for it because it played a part into your betterment. And so I'll never forget, man, when I first met you, right? And I think it was on your visit. And everybody was talking about you. And I had saw you play. And I was like, man, this cat vicious, right? Like, E.B., when did you fall in love with the game of football?
I think I fell in love with the game of football because it took me to a place where I could honestly express myself. Mm-hmm. And it was hard for me to do that in words. It was hard for me to do that. Period. And my dad, you know, he was, you know, very instrumental in my life, dog. And it was a point in middle school where I was just headed down the wrong path. I was just doing so much bad stuff, man. Just doing it.
Yeah.
Once my dad, he just set me down. He was like, man, you can't continue going down this path, man. Like, I know, you know, it gets hard. And I really just poured into football, and it never was about the accolades for me. It was me releasing, because I had so much pain, so much anger, so much just stuff built up, and I never knew how to express it. writing was one of it. My dad told me to start writing, and that was something that got a lot of things out of my system. So even just to touch on it, when I was in school and you used to write me those letters before games, that really touched me because I understood what you was going through, because sometimes you can't talk to somebody about what you're going through or what you're thinking about. You have to put that stuff down on paper. So having said that, being able to express myself and fully express myself on the football field, and you know how it is, like, there's no turning back once you step in between those white lines. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's going to be what it's going to be, you know, and just understanding that you're going to be vulnerable. It's going to be things on that field that you can't do. It's going to be things that you have weaknesses, and it's all on film. You can't hide on film. But understanding and having people on the same side as you who can cover up your weakness, because they're going to go just as hard for the same thing that you want to do. You know what I'm saying? So just, it's so many things. It's a layered concept. And I think I understood that football was a big part of life. It wasn't no separation between the two. Mm. I think I understood that at a young age, simply because my dad was like, the same way you approach things on the field, that's how you need to approach things in life. And that's how we communicated. That's how we bonded, because he couldn't get through to me just, you know, because I was one of those kids that was getting whoopings. I was getting in trouble. But
so I was getting whoopings.
I was, man. And it just, some things wasn't clicking. When he used football as a lesson, a teaching tool for me. And I think that's when I started to realize, once I started actually getting involved in the process and paying attention, and riding home with him after practice, saying, like, that's how you approach the game. That when I say you're not running, that's what I mean by you're not running. You're supposed to run like this, or you're supposed to be low like this, because it's the same way when you're doing your own work. You got to create leverage somehow. You got to create leverage with your knowledge. You got to create leverage with your discipline, because we're at a disadvantage from the get-go, you know? So you got to make sure that you do everything in your power to put yourself in position to be successful.
No doubt, man. And I know your family, man. You come from a great family, you know, great mother, man, great father, your brothers. You spoke about writing them notes, and I wanted to show you this, right? I still got it, like the notes that you wrote to me with your goals. You know what I'm saying? I got them in my office. I show them to my son. You know what I'm saying? And I never forget, like, I was showing my wife one day, and she was like, did EB accomplish some of those goals? On the paper, I was like, it's crazy. He accomplished all of them.
Yes.
Right? And so the importance of that, bro, like how important, like you say, your dad taught you to write and all these things. How important was setting goals to you, whether it be coming up or when you got to the University of Tennessee and thereafter, just in terms of your life guide of setting goals and writing things down?
Man, it's big, because my dad, he was big on vision. Mm-hmm. And seeing it before you do it. Like, he actually used to make me sit down and visualize what I wanted to do, not just in football games, but in life too. And I think just being able to, you know, craft those visions and visualize, you know, making that interception and taking it back for 70 yards, or, you know, doing that homework and staying committed to reading books when you didn't want to read it, but making sure you did so because you could know the content for the test. I mean, just visually doing that and putting your mind into that, you know, just building momentum, mm-hmm. just thinking about it and building momentum. But the thing about writing it down, you know, I keep talking about my dad because I don't take that for granted.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't take that for granted. And some of the lessons that I learned, even just by watching him, like seeing him up at 6:30 in the morning, planning out his day, mm-hmm. writing the things down that he wanted to do, you know, just, all right, he got a house to paint, a house to clean. He's going to do that at 12 o'clock. He's going to get off. He's going to cook dinner for the family, you know, take us to practice, get off practice, go to work the third shift, get up, take a nap for 3 hours. Like, he had this stuff written out, and I'm looking at it. You know, he'll leave it on the table downstairs. I see him thinking about doing these things, and I go look at it like, wow, this is what he's doing. So I think just him writing it down, not only is it, you know, remembering and being able, not only just knowing it and having it down so you don't forget, because the faintest pen is stronger than the strongest memory. And he could refer back to it and see what he wanted to do and make sure he stayed dedicated to that. But as far as the goals go, what an injustice it would be to say that you wanted to do something, but you don't even take the time to write that down.
Wow.
If you don't write that down, like, the simplest thing you could do to bring it to a physical form is write it down. And it doesn't take much, so you might as well write it down. I think what took it to the next level when I met you, because my dad always told me to write my goals down.
Absolutely.
When I met you, you told me to write down what I was going to sacrifice to make it to those goals. And I never thought about it that way.
Yeah.
You told me to write down what I was going to sacrifice and what I was going to commit to. So if you look at that sheet, it has the things that I was going to do in order to reach that level or reach those accomplishments. And even though those accomplishments were on those, like, I think I had the Thorpe Award winner on there. Had it on there.
Got it on here.
But I had the things that I was going to commit to up under it.
Right.
And I never focused on the Thorpe Award. I had to commit to the things that I wrote under there.
Wow.
And I think it just puts everything in perspective. You know, it puts everything in perspective. And it, like you always say, man, it's not about how can you stay committed to something without being emotionally attached to it?
Absolutely.
I was so focused on not letting myself down on what I committed to that when I got the award, it was like, okay, cool. Yeah. But look at these habits. Look at these habits I developed. You know what I'm saying? I developed these habits, developed this system to where I can take this to a business. I can take this to the next level. I can take this to my family and my friends and my loved ones, and they can depend on me just because I developed that character and that habit.
Yeah, man. It's like the quote that says, what's more important, what you acquire or who you become? It speaks to what you're saying. Like, when you got a goal, you got dreams, you got aspirations, you write down what you got to sacrifice and what you're going to commit to in order to make it happen, because the process is what builds us, as you know. You know what I'm saying? The process of chasing every single day. But along that process, we face opposition, we face adversity, and we face challenges. And it's a mindset that's formed with that. And so when you was at Tennessee, like, you were incredible. You was all world. Like, they sung your name on campus. You know what I'm saying? You had your own song, right? Joint was dope, right? But I'll never forget when you first got there, like, some of the guys, the older guys, like, some of them didn't want to let you in on the plays. They didn't want to tell you some of the things because they felt like, man, this cat could possibly take my position, right? Mm-hmm. And you had to fight and you had to claw. But you did your thing, you worked hard, and of course, the rest was history. But along that process, when you first got to Tennessee, EB, and you had this fire, you had this desire, and you wanted to be great, right? Like, what was that process and that mindset like when you got on campus and you was working towards some of the things you went on to accomplish?
And it was just that I had built that up in my spirit before I even got there. I didn't come to Tennessee and develop my spirit. It was, I already came in there with the mindset that I wasn't going to back down. I wasn't going to give up. I wasn't going to half step it because I already had this mentality, dog. And you know how it is when you cultivate something for a long time and you commit to it, it ain't too much that's going to stop that.
No doubt.
Well, even with the opposition, and even with the ups and downs, the surgeries and stuff like that, it was just like, oh, man, I'm not. I know where I come from. I'm a Berry, man. Like, I'm a Berry, bro. And I came up here to represent my dad. I came here to represent my aunties. You know what I'm saying? I just came here to just do something for my community because, dude, I'm from Fairburn, Georgia, a little small right outside Atlanta. Down. You know what I'm saying? My mom wanted me to go to a private school. She wanted me to go to Woodward Academy. Mm-hmm. And she wanted me to go to Landmark. And I told her straight up, like, I'm not going there because I want to put Fairburn on the map. I want to make sure that, you know what I'm saying, like, these kids can say, you know what, let me go to Creekside. Eric Berry went to Creekside.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? He came straight from the swamp, did what he had to do, and made it happen.
No doubt.
And I think that was also a big part of me committing to football and staying out of trouble and getting my grades because I didn't want to go to a private school. That wasn't me. My friends went to Creekside, and that's what I wanted to do. So just coming in and also having great males pouring into me, like my coach, Willie Channing, he came from Deerfield, Florida. He coached Brent Schaefer and Chris Gamble.
Oh, wow.
Brent Schaefer played quarterback at UT.
Yeah.
So, you know, the same way I came in, like, I was in my sophomore year and he came in, he was the linebacker coach, but eventually became my defensive back coach. And he cultivated that mindset in me every single day because the first day I met him, he said, oh, you that Eric Berry kid. I heard a lot about you, but I'm gonna tell you like this, cats like you, where I'm from, come a dime a dozen. What's going to make you stand out from them? I'm from Florida. I'm from Miami, dog. He told me just like this.
Yeah.
Like, I'm from Miami, dog. You got to show me something and prove something to me because it's a cat just like you that I see. I can pick him up off the street and do everything you're doing. And to be honest, it struck a nerve with me because I was already working. I was already doing what I was supposed to. But that took my game to the next level because I wanted to prove it to him. And then right before that, my dad also had a conversation with me saying that he felt like I wasn't working. And that hurt my spirit. Like, that really touched me. He was like, because I had a strong freshman year. real strong freshman year, going into my sophomore year, and I'm feeling myself, to be honest with you, teenager, you know what I'm saying, about to turn 16. You know how it is.
Oh, no doubt.
And he set me down. He was like, dude, you're not working. You're not working. And that hurt me to have my dad say I'm not working, to say that, to see those things that he's writing down before he goes to work, seeing his list of things to do, and him looking at me and say, I'm not putting in the type of work.
Wow.
So what I did was I ended up writing down what I was going to do and what I was going to commit to. And I ended up getting the keys to the janitor from the janitor. I actually got him to give me the keys so I could open up the school and go work out.
Wow.
Me, you, Rakevious, Terrence Parks, and my friend Bankston Evans, you know what I'm saying? We used to go and get to the school at 5:30 before the janitor. We opened up. The only thing we had to do was make sure we didn't lose the keys. And we did that every morning in the off season, dog. And I think that sense of accountability and seeing my dad somewhat disappointed and challenging me, and seeing that I had another coach challenge me in the sense to where I wasn't doing reaching my potential when I thought I was, I think that's what I came into the school. That's why I came into Tennessee with the fire that I had, because I didn't like that feeling, and I never wanted to have anyone question my work ethic or question what I was doing. Yeah, the talent is there. Talent is there. But that's not what I was about. I didn't want to let my dad, the males that was around me, my family, I didn't want to let them down and say that I wasn't working. And that hurt. That really hurt. Honestly, that hurt.
That's real. A lot of cats don't take it personal. You know what I'm saying? Like, how you speaking about it, like, you like, man, I took it personal. Like, when that came from my dad, and I know that feeling, like, when you got a male you respect, like, you don't want to let them down. You want to make them proud, especially when they've showed you and poured into you, right? Like, that means something. And so you accomplished something that, you know, not a lot of cats get to accomplish in terms of from the time they're kids until, you know, they get drafted. You got drafted, right? Like, highest DB drafted, I think, since Sean Taylor at the time, right? And you accomplished that dream. And I know a lot of people played a part in you getting there in terms of your family and your coaches. But, of course, you working for it. Like, what did that day feel like, E, when it happened?
Man, it felt really good. It felt so good. But that was just a part of the process. Like, that was a part of the success. Like, I wanted to sustain success.
No doubt.
I wanted to, you know, show consistency. Like, I wanted to be able to get there and, you know, just continue to impact and empower my people, because it's just so much. Like, you got younger brothers following you. Like, absolutely. You want to make sure they have a good example and show them, like, you can really do this. You can really get to this level. But this is not what it's about. This is not the last stop. You got to continue to grow, continue to develop. And the thing I wanted to do when I got to the league is just continue to grow as a person.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? Because I felt like if I went to college and I grew so much with the experiences that I had on and off the field, I wanted to know how good of a person and as a human being I could become with the same challenges in the NFL. So, I mean, I just really wanted to grow. I was addicted to growth and just seeing how good I could become, you know, on the field, man. I love doing things on the field, but off the field, I just felt like I was growing into something that, you know, that I could be proud of, and I wanted to continue to do that.
Yeah. You know, E, watching you play on NFL, like, man, it was incredible. You know what I'm saying? Like, watching you do your thing, watching the spirit of what you played with. And I'll never forget when cancer came into your life. You know what I'm saying? And, like, when my injury hit me, I always tell people, like, even though you know injuries can happen, even though you know, like, careers can end behind the injury, like, I just never thought about my life in that way. Like, I thought, yeah, I can get injured. Of course, injuries happen. But I never thought I'd go out, play the game one day, something happens to me, wake up the next day, and my life is totally changed. I just never thought about it like that, even though it was reality, right? And so when you got hit with cancer, like, navigating that process, you get hit with cancer, I think it's 2014, right? And you come back 2015, the next year you come back and you ball and you go to the Pro Bowl. But when that happened to you, like, talk a little bit about your mindset and your perspective and the people that were around you in terms of your parents and you getting through that.
Man, it was tough, dude, because like you said, it caught me completely off guard. And I wasn't prepared for it. Hmm. Like, I wasn't aware of it. I found out I was prepared for it, but I wasn't aware of it. And I was so out of touch with what was going on. When they told me the news, I was like, well, can I still play before, you know what I'm saying, before my chemo session, man? And they were like, dude, like, no, you can't, bro. You got to go get chemotherapy.
You ready.
That's done, bro. Like, but that's just how I was. I was like, shoot, I might as well just play another game until it's really time. But I think before all that went down, I was in like the best shape of my life, dude. I was mentally focused. I had sacrificed like eating certain things. I committed to waking up. Like, I'm not even Muslim, but I did Ramadan just to see if I could stay committed to it. You know what I'm saying? Like, wow. I just did it. You know what I mean? And then right after that, like, to find out that happened, and I think in my journal I had wrote, is it possible to turn pain to power? Mm. Is it possible for you to look at pain and say, and be in the moment of pain and be like, this is really me becoming empowered?
Wow.
And I was like, I think I wrote that in on 8/14/14. Mm. And right after that, like throughout that season, that's what started happening. Wow. And I got to the point where I was like, dude, like, why, how did I end up in this situation? Why am I going through this? I was in the best shape of my life. I've been eating clean, drinking water, doing what I was supposed to do. And it was just like a ton of bricks that hit me. So going through the process, I think you gave me this coin. It had like the breastplate of righteousness and, you know what I'm saying, the helmet of salvation and everything. And I kept that coin with me. And you told me, like, we went to homegrown. And you was like, man, when are you taking chemotherapy? And you was like, I said, I'm going to do it every Wednesday, every 2 weeks. Mm. You said, that's your game day. Mm. I was like, all right, cool. I get it. Okay, this is my game day. So I'm going to treat it like a game and be ready for my game. Yeah. And you got 12 rounds, like just like a boxer. You're going to knock out each round. Yeah. So when I put it in perspective like that for me, I was like, I am prepared for it. It's the same thing that I've been doing in football. Like, it's going to be times that it's going to be a camp that is going to break me down. You got to get up, go to film. You got to work out. You got to train. You got to push your body to the limit. That's the same thing that was going on, but it wasn't just physical. It was more mental. You know what I'm saying? It was more mental and it was more of my spirit. And what I learned throughout that whole process is that if it's in your spirit, it's going to be hard for you to be broken mentally and physically. Mm. I had to do it in reverse because I was broken mentally. I ended up reaching point zero. I was broken mentally and I was broken physically to the point where, you know, I had lost a lot of weight, 195. I'm looking in the mirror, don't recognize myself. And I really got down to the core of who I was as an individual, as my character, not by, oh, that's Eric Berry. You know, he's handsome or he's physically fit. He's a football player. I had to separate myself from that and really cultivate my spirit. And it was times where mentally I was there, but physically I wasn't there. Mm. There was a time where I was physically there, but I mentally wasn't there. And it's cool to say that, you know, you got serendipity as the name of your show, because you have to create that will and that cycle of serendipity. It's not going to always be mental. It's not going to always be physical. It's a continuous thing that you feed off of. And you got to grow it into a serendipitous will so it can cultivate that spirit, and that spirit can maintain and sustain you through any situation. And I think that was the biggest thing that I learned throughout that process, is just, it's going to be ups and downs, but that's just a part of the process. You have to step back and look and say, I'm going to be right back out of this thing, man. And back to the good times and the great times. But this is a part that cultivates you. into that, having that spirit and being able to move forward and grow in the way that you want to.
Man, that's an incredible perspective, bro. Like, I always say to people, like, when we go through things in life, like, a lot of times, immediately, we want to understand it, right? That's the natural reaction. Like you said, like, man, what is this? I remember I get hit. I'm like, man, what? Like, break your plexus. Like,
yeah, don't even
this? You try yeah. to understand it. You know what I'm saying? But I tell people all the time, I said, oftentimes, man, we got to focus that energy and that passion on surviving it, right? Just survive the moment. Like you said, some days you're going to be there mentally, you won't be there physically. Some days you're going to be there physically, you won't be there mentally. Just focus on surviving it. And then we get to a certain point along the journey, you look back and you start putting the pieces together, and now you can understand it, the purpose that it serves, right? The things you can extract from it to make you a better individual and carry on. But, like, the thing that has impressed me about you, E, is that, like, at every phase of adversity, like, you find a way to navigate and shake back, man, and execute even on a higher level. Right. And when I look at you, right, if a cat meets you, I'll never forget. I was with somebody. We were somewhere and like you was there. You was on you had on a jogging suit. Right. Like, I think one of your nonchalant joints or something. And a cat was like, that's EB. Like, that's Eric Berry. I'm like, yeah. He's like, man, a cat just chilling. Like, he just calm. Right. And a lot of what you all talk about, even with the brand, is humble savage. Right. Right. Like a humble savage. Right. Adapt to disrupt. Right. Where did that come from, EB, in terms of just putting that into the brand, you and Savion and the team, and that really being like y'all personality?
Yeah, man, because that's what it is. Like, at the root, at the core, nonchalant is simple. Being nonchalant is being poised. Mm. It's being poised in those times of adversity, in those times of disruption, you know, that can kind of knock you off your path or knock you off your pivot. Like, yeah. Being poised in those situations, that's what gets you through. Being able to say, you know what? I did say I was going to commit to this. I knew that it was going to be times like that. Acknowledging the moment, acknowledging that it is adversity. Damn. And knowing and understanding that every time, my dad, man, he always told me, mom, too, like, it's always going to be something happening. Mm. So don't be surprised. Just be prepared for it. You know, and being prepared for it is just being mentally tough and conditioned. Mm. At the end of the day, that's all you have to be, is mentally tough and conditioned. We can make everything else work. So being able to be a humble savage, trying to find that balance between being humble, because sometimes if you're too humble and it's mistaken and not being confident, sometimes you forget who you are and where you've been. Those tough times that you did endure, those tough times that you did overcome, sometimes you might forget that if you're too humble. Yeah. You got to understand that you've been through a lot and you've conquered a lot. So you have to be aware of that. But being balanced with the savage aspect to where it's like, man, I'm a dog. I can get this done.
Certified, right.
I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. I'm going to get it done. But not being savage to the point where it's just like, you know what I'm saying, just ruthless and not really aware of your surroundings. You got to be, know what's going on. And keep having that balance of being a humble savage and being able to have that rotation in that cycle to be able to push through what you want to.
Absolutely. And so, E, as I take us out, man, with the current climate of the world, right, pandemic, a lot of people facing a lot of adversity and opposition, you know, seeing times that they've never seen before. Is there a mantra that you live by or something that you wake up and you think about every single day, something that guides you? Right. That you will leave the world with. Right. That you will put on people as they navigate through opposition, adversity and good days.
Man, the biggest thing for me, you know, as far as a mantra. I don't really have a mantra. My thing is, I just want to empower people. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? I want to empower them by what I do, by the way I move, the way I accomplish things. And what I notice is you brought up my cancer situation, and the thing that I didn't realize until people started coming to me, a lot of people don't recognize me from football. Mm. A lot of people, they come up to me and say, thank you, because my dad watched your speech or watched your story on YouTube every day during chemotherapy. You know what I'm saying? Or they say, my granny, they watched you before they passed away. You know what I'm saying? And you was a center of hope. And like making like accolades like all decade team and, you know, winning the Thorpe Award and the SEC Player of the Year. Like, that doesn't amount to saving someone's life by inspiring them to continue to push on and continue to live. So the only thing I could say, man, is really just for anybody out there that's going through something, just try to be better than you are at this present moment tomorrow. Like, even if you had a bad day, just understand if you got an opportunity tomorrow, just be better than that and continue and try to build on that. And don't worry about, you know, outside people saying that you should be here or should be there. Mm-hmm. Focus on yourself and continue to just cultivate a spirit of growth and being positive and reaching for the stars, man. That's really all it's about, because you never know who you might inspire. I didn't know I was inspiring all those people. I was just fighting for my life. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, it's a lot of people out there that's fighting for their life as well, and they need that inspiration. So you got to just continue to push on and continue to push forward, because you saving your life might save thousands.
That's strong, bro. They say, EB, when you have a bad day, the next day you wake up, you try to treat the world better than it treated you. And so, man, I want to say thank you for your time, bro. We greatly appreciate it. Thank you for your wisdom. Thank you for your insight. You know it's nothing but love and respect, man. Appreciate it.
Man, I appreciate you too, man.
Yeah.